very basic focus subjects like marketing, finance, operations, HR, and now you get the integrations coming in. So this is the stage actually where things are getting integrated. Leadership, there are two areas here. We are talking about corporate leadership. That is, there are so many types of leadership. You get leadership of countries, you get leadership in houses, and all those are leadership. We also lead ourselves. We lead ourselves into the future. This focus is more on the corporate leadership. That means anyone who is an organization, not necessarily the CEO. CEO, of course, is generally considered as a leader of the entire organization. But at every level, there are leaders. Say, for example, after the CEO, you might get the COO, Chief Operating Officer. People report to him and he has to lead them. Then the managers themselves have to lead their reportees. And finally, right at the bottom, you might get a supervisor sometimes who has to lead. So this word leading, sometimes it's not very complex, but in management, what we mean is the future. Going into the future. In management, it means going into the future. All of us have two basic responsibilities. One is we have to manage. Manage generally, when you say managing, we are focusing on now. Now, so you look at your resources, whatever you have tasks to fulfill. Already they have been decided, those tasks are decided. And you have resources. The usual resources are people, capital, information sometimes, technology, and how well you use that. For management is how well you use those resources to achieve your goals. And therefore you have to be efficient. A manager has to be efficient. That is because how much he'll get out of the resources he has, the output upon input. But leadership is another responsibility for any one of us. That is, when we look into the future, we have to, sometimes the future is uncertain, we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. There's some idea, but not 100%. We need to see visions. We need to actually vision something of the future. What do you want to do in the future? And then you have to lead. You have to move everyone forward to achieve that future. So that aspect of thing is not the present, but planning the future and strategizing, using strategy to achieve that future. Strategy, why you need strategy is because there's so many uncertain things. Things change. Everything changes. And today especially, change is very rapid. We normally refer to it as a VUCA environment. VUCA. VUCA means volatile, uncertain, challenging, I think, and ambiguous. We don't know, actually. So VUCA. This new term has come because of a famous futurologist who works in Google, I think, called Ray Kurzweil. Have you heard of Ray Kurzweil? He's a guy who works in Google. He found that future is accelerating. The things are, in the future, are accelerating. They are not going in a linear fashion. Technology particularly. Is going on a e to the x kind of curve, exponential, that is rapid increase for every, you look at periods like this, you'll find that it doesn't go as a linear function, but more kind of accelerating, mainly because of technology. We are discovering new technologies and also new knowledge. So nothing is, it's getting more uncertain. In other words, we really don't know. If a new technology comes, everything changes. So, what is impossible today might be possible in a short time. Organizations will not be the same as they are now because of technology. I think even individuals, any one of us, will be working in more than one organization in another 10 years. 3-4 organizations you will be able to work with. It will be very difficult for an organization to hold people. Because you are so free, you can work from home, you can work from anywhere. And you become like a node. And people will see your talents and they will search for talent. So you will be able to be like in a network rather than in an organization. So these kind of changes are very uncertain. So in spite of this uncertainty, you have to plan. You have to try to vision. Vision means see the future. See the future. And then not only seeing the future, you need to go to the future. To go to the future, you have to deal with this uncertainty and things like that and find some strategies to overcome possible challenges you might see and also threats maybe to what you are doing now and things like that. So that aspect is leadership. So in order to, quite different, any one of us have both these responsibilities. One is look at what you have to do now, look at your resources and try to make the best out of the resources. So then we are talking about efficiency. So efficiency is usually an output upon input. So management is focusing on efficiency, normally we give this, and that is output upon input. And this is now. You have to focus on now also. Now can be about this month also, not only this second. Leadership is always dealing with the future. That is, you have goals. You plan for goals. These are planned goals, and the degree of achievement of that planned goal is a degree of leadership. It's quite different. You are looking at the future, you are looking at trying to do things in the future, and how much of those things you planned, you fulfill. So in other words, we are talking about achievement. Achievement of goals is a kind of a role of leadership. So in order to achieve that, there are a lot of behaviors. This leadership thing is an area of behavior. We try to study people who do these things, successful leaders. What did they do? You can't, a real measure of leadership is achievement. If someone doesn't achieve, you may be a very good manager. That is your managing now. But if I, what did you do actually? Basically, what did you plan to do and what did you do? So it's always when you plan, it's in the future. You have to lead. Not only yourself, but you have to lead others as well. So leading is actually a very interesting subject because sometimes we look at the kind of psychology of leaders. Some leaders are very good guys where transactions are concerned. They can really transact well, very efficiently sometimes. And those kind of leaders actually also are useful, but sometimes transformational. It's change things totally, change organizations, change the way people think, create new type of innovations and things like that. So that kind of leadership is a little different. It's generally referred to as transformation. Therefore leadership has so many terms, types of, is it transactional leaders, transformational leaders, transcendental leaders, guru type of leaders, transcendental, you know, they are seeing greater things in the future and they are trying to teach people how to do things, so many types of leadership. You get people talk about visionary leaders, people talk about even servant leaders, right? Servant leader is someone who serves, and there's people like Mother Teresa and people like that. They led organizations, and they served a group of people. So that's a different type of leadership. So you have so many types of leadership. We'll be talking about some of these things as we go on. It's a very interesting subject. So we have this particular subject is behavioral, right? We normally study leaders who have been there. Very little theoretical stuff on this because there's too much of theory. So therefore we try to study successful people who have done things, who have achieved things, and try to say, okay, how did they achieve it? What kind of behavior did they use? What did they do? So there are so many types of things. So we are looking at that. And our leadership thing is more focusing on organizations. You can talk about leadership like presidents and people like that. Right? You look at the leadership styles of Trump and so I think both are really bad, right? Right. Clinton, okay. How do you see them as leaders? So that's a vast area. We are not going to deal with that. But occasionally we look at patterns like that also and try to see, okay, there is some behavior that you can understand from those people also, which gets reflected in organizations, the way people do things. So there are various types of leaders. So this is a very interesting subject that way, very behavioral. And you might make your own theories, in fact. There may be no, not yet. There are so many theories emerging about leadership. Now, if you look at someone like Richard Branson, how would you say? First step, you have to decide that he's a leader. Why? Because there's so much of achievement. He has achieved so much of things. Look at the number of organizations. So therefore, he is a leader. So our definition is, if you try to aim at something and achieve it, you're a leader. Because he has gone into that. He has taken people and he has seen how he can do things. Even all his organizations are visionary organizations. The latest one was trying to take people into space. Right? What is that called? I can't. Virgin Galactica. Right. It failed, but that's no problem. He has learned from the failure. And he will find a way of doing it. But if you look at his background, he doesn't have an MBA or something like that. In fact, he was dyslexic. Dyslexic means actually he can't understand things clearly sometimes. He left school at the age of 14 years, didn't do even the O-level. But it's very strange. So we are saying, okay, how did this guy manage to do this? Where did he get that thing? It's a very interesting study. Even in our own countries, we can see some people like that. But that doesn't mean that you don't have to have an MBA or something. That now people like you look at Google, those two guys, Larry Page and with the other guy, yeah, Larry Page and those two guys, they are actually PhD material. They think actually they are. Yeah, actually they did PhDs, but Bill Gates dropped out, Steve Jobs dropped out. So it's very difficult to understand how they did, but there must be some things that's very common to all these guys. That's what we are trying to get at. What's so common about that? One thing, if you look at, all of them have a futuristic. They saw some different thing in the future, something different. If Steve Jobs did not see the computer used by everyone before Steve Jobs' time, the computer was essentially a scientific tool. It was only meant for scientists, engineers, and people like that. I remember the time I first studied computers. We didn't have Windows or anything like that. Even before MS-DOS came in, I had a Sinclair Spectrum computer. I don't know whether you ever heard of it. I bought it for 2,000 rupees and you plugged it into the television and you get a full, screen with rain, and then some very vague white letters come in and it slowly went on to doing things. There was no, even floppy was one of the, right? You just have to, the only way you could save your, what you did was by writing it down. There was no, I can remember the first time we did practicals, we learned Fortran.
There was something called punch card, no?
Punch card was a different thing, yes. Yes, punch card was there. Punch card was actually a series of, but that was actually slightly used for different purposes. Not so much for, more like Braille, something like that. So anyway, today, how things have gone, one thing is that Steve Jobs moved it into, he saw these icons and things like that, all those kind of things, the mouse came into the scene and it moved in, and eventually MS-DOS moved into, Windows was bought by Microsoft, but it was not created by them, right? So why did they do that? They saw a future, they saw a market, they saw something else beyond scientists using computers. So what made them do that? What? Sometimes it is a psychological thing. So sometimes leadership is studied from psychological angle, the behavioral aspect. Can you create leaders? Earlier they said leaders are born. But if you over to wait till all leaders are born, we won't develop. You must find management as a solution to develop leaders. So we have our whole subject we are talking about is how you can scientifically create leaders. So therefore we must know the elements, what makes leaders and things like that. So whatever we are going to talk about in this some 10 sessions like are very basic thinking, but they are useful, like sometimes very useful. But we also reflect back into the past what people have been talking. They have been leaders historically. That's the time we actually talk about, there is the study about leadership. It's not a new thing. In the ancient time, there were kings. And kings were leaders. So there were advisors to kings. And the people who advised kings had some idea about how to develop leadership in kings, because it was a very big task to lead a country, and some of these countries actually developed very fast, like Rome, like Greece, like Egypt. How did that happen? If you study, okay, the leadership style of Ramesses II, for example, a major pharaoh, he ruled for 60 years, one of the most successful pharaohs. Then in the Indian continent also, people like Chandragupta, Maurya, and people like that, why did they do that? So some of these things we are talking about today are how this today, that is the first session, is the development of the study of leadership from historical background. So that's what we are going to talk about, very interesting. So let's look at some of these historical insights. The screen came in, that's what happened. Holiday and screen came in. Right. Here are some of the insights, and they're still good. Actually, sometimes you get an idea about leadership. This is now sir. That TSU is pronounced as sir. Chinese. Lao Tzu was actually advisor to the first emperor of China, the guy who built the Great Wall of China. Now kings themselves did things, but there were guys who advised these people, and they had an idea about how to develop leadership. So we have, it's still there, that idea is still there. Lao Tzu was actually, he was a soldier and a general during his young days, but as he grew older, he became a wise man, right? And he advised this king. Something he built at that time, as you know, the mathematics had not evolved. There was no Cartesian X and Y axis and all that kind of thing like that. But there were models. This model is normally referred to as the yin-yang. Y-I-N, yin-yang. And this model can be used to explain a lot of things, and including leadership. What Lao Tzu found out is that if you want to be a leader, right? Now you know what a leader is? A leader is someone who takes people into a future, sees a future and then takes people into the future. So kings actually saw a future for their country, and sometimes they had to have strategies. Those days, of course, it was not acquisition of knowledge, but it was acquisition of land. So you can see how these empires grew by conquering other countries. And why? Because land had resources, and therefore you become more rich if you have more resources, natural resources. And so they went on to conquer resources. Anyway, it was not easy to do that. You had armies, you had people like that, you have to inspire those guys. You have to give them very big ideas, and you must also tell them a lot of things. Like for example, this idea is a good idea. And you must make them believe that it's a good idea. And not only that, you must always try to get people, if you're a leader, get people to go beyond their capabilities. Now all of us have, this is a very important thing to understand, right? We have abilities. We are able now to do many things. So this is ability. But beyond ability, there are so many things you can do which you don't, you may be not thinking about now. And if that's that beyond thing is called capability. You are capable of doing things sometimes which you never thought you can do. But you may not think that now. Now you know what you can do and what you can do well. That's your ability. But we have capabilities. Capability is something beyond ability. And that is immense. Now a leader has to point out and try to understand people's capabilities, not abilities. What are they capable? And that's where the idea about talent comes in. Basically, people have talents. They can not only do what they have learned to do and they can do now, but there is a future for them. Something they have never tried before. Now the leader is a guy who sees that. So he has to inspire people to look at their capabilities. What more can they do? So sometimes soldiers will say, no, we can't fight those guys have better weapons and things like that. But there are leaders who with very small armies have fought very large armies as well, because they went with their capabilities and not their ability only. So the leader is the guy who does that. Now the question is how to get there? How can anyone else get there? What now sir says is start developing someone else. It's a very strange mantra. If you want to be a leader, there are reportees. You have reportees, start developing them and see their capability and not only their ability. When you do that, you change. You become also better. This is the philosophy. That is, if you want to increase your effectiveness as a leader, help others to develop and grow. And if you help others to develop and grow, it will increase your effectiveness as a leader. This model is a very dynamic model. It keeps moving round and round. It's a thing that was found out. Say, if you want to be a very good parent, you focus on your children and try to see, okay, what are your children's talents and start moving them. When you do that, you also learn it. And then you can now talk more. You also become better. So this idea, so if you are a manager, if you want to be a good leader, if we are going back 3000 years, this is 3000 years ago, Lao Tzu, and take his philosophy and apply it to our management today, it says focus on your people who are reporting to you, see what's beyond them, what their capabilities, and try to develop them. When you do that, you won't be the same person. There's something that happens and then you become better. They will never become better than you. That is a very famous philosophy according to this. You will change, you will move, you will also move. So if what he said is, to leaders, to like kings, to always look at your people, the people in the country, the soldiers, everyone else, that they are capable of doing bigger things. When they do that, automatically his mentality changes. So it's a very old philosophy, still workable. And try it and see. Okay. Really, it works. really speaking. So today we have so many areas in real practical sense used on this coaching, for example. Say when someone is working with you, it's an opportunity to coach. You can watch the work and help out on the technical aspects. Technical helping on the technical aspects is coaching. But there is another aspect that you have to help on, that's the social aspects. Because what happens when people, if you want to develop people, not only have you to increase their technical abilities, you have to also take them forward socially. Because our societies, world, basically human societies have different behaviors at different levels. So when you are a junior managers have one level of behavior. The moment you get promoted, you suddenly feel a cultural shock. People are different. Socially they are different, their habits are different, the way they behave is different. You get into the board one day, the board of directors, you find the behavior is different. So there is a social kind of thing was that. For that you require mentoring. So as a leader, if you want to develop your people, there are two things you must do. Look at their capabilities and then develop their technical as well as social skills. When you do that, you won't be the same, according to Lao Tzu. So best is to fight and see. My own experience is, yes, it is possible. Right? It's possible. If you see bigger people than what they are capable, you will also become greater. So that's Lao Tzu's philosophy. So some of these things people today refer to this, these theories because they are well tested and founded theories. Now this is one aspect of leadership, that is how to be a leader. A very simple mantra to develop your guys. A very simple mantra. So it's that's Lao Tzu. Let's go on to another. You know what's happening? This holiday thing is popping up. How do you take this off totally?
Disable Wi-Fi.
When that comes, it blocks the other thing. Sorry? No, no, I don't need any money. Referring to different models or historical models, because these are things that have been tested and we have to revisit and look at it in a new way, because they are true. I mean, time has changed, styles have changed, and the applications have changed. Those days, the application of leadership was mostly for ruling countries and things like that. Here is an Indian model which comes from basically from the time of the Mahabharata, quite old, right? And says that some kind of, here we are talking about behaviors, the roles of a leader. The roles of a leader, when you are a leader, what are your roles, what are the roles you have to play? It's not a simple role, it's a very multiple faceted role that you have to play. This is true. For example, one is that you have to be a performer. This Indian word is karta. Okay, you can't be a guy who doesn't have a track record. You have to be some kind of a performer. You have to be known to be a good performer. So you have to achieve that. That is, you have to be a kind of, in some way, a skillful person, I would say. Skilled in something or the other. Some people known for some kind of behavior. Then the other one is, the word karma is that you have to do things, you have to act. The word karma is sometimes negatively connoted. We say karume, mage karume and all that kind of thing. Make a mage karume. But karma doesn't mean only that. Karma means when you do something, it might turn out to be good or bad. So if you have negative action, it will turn out to be bad karma. But if you could do things, good things, it will turn out to be good for you. I mean, it has a way of returning. That's the whole idea. This principle of karma is a very important thing because it accrues. When you do something good, somewhere something is accrued. Even among people, people have emotional bank balances when you do something good. But they will return that one day. This is a very important factor of karma. In fact, one of the people who tried to change this concept of negative karma was Anagarika Dharmapada. If you read his writings, he has interpreted this thing, and he said the end of karma is karma anta. That is, karma anta is actually, maybe, I don't know. That is, if you do good things, it turns out to accrue profits in certain ways, social profit plus profit maximization or whatever it is, but you have to do something. So this idea about action is very important. Then typical very Asian idea is looking at your reportees and the people that you lead as a family. It's a very Asian idea about leadership. May not be there so much among the West, but the East looked at if you have a group of people you lead, look at them as children. Very patronizing type of model, but it's Asia. Right? Even you can see that happening actually in some of our Asian organizations, that the leader is looked at as a parent sometimes, you know, in that kind of sense. It's maybe very Asian. So that's a kutum. Kutum actually means a family and something like that. Then, very important thing, leader should have compassion. Today we have a lot of terms that come under that, like emotional intelligence and things like that. Is to understand emotions of people, and we have empathy, for example. Empathy is not sympathy. Empathy is understanding people. You may not agree with someone, but if you can understand why a person is in a certain way, then you have a key to his, an answer to his problem. Right? But if you challenge it, then there is no answer. Right? So therefore you have to, this idea about compassion is a very human thing. And of course a very important thing, is shown as the fifth dimension of leadership in this Indian model, is Kesari. Kesari actually means sacrifice and giving up pleasures now for a better future, that kind of thing, which is actually a very important self-discipline that comes as a result of doing that. I'm sure you are doing that now, otherwise you won't be here in the evening, right? You are doing some Kesari, right? Because, what? Yeah? Yes, yes,
okay.
What? That's some food from the
super
case. Super case.
Super
case. What? Super case. Super case. So the whole idea is sometimes this whole idea about accruing profit and things like that is, say you don't spend all the money you have, you put it aside, and then it evolves, and then you can use it when you want to use it. So this principle of sacrificing or wasting resources at any time for a better time is a principle of leadership. So that actually, if you look at that, it's in a national sense, it is very important. Sometimes you have to balance enjoyment versus resource allocations and things like that for how you invest. For example, investment comes as a result of that. What do you invest in? What do you invest your time in? So there you put off your thing for a better day. This actually was studied psychologically among children at one time. This was done by psychologist you know, David McLaren. He had actually tested it out with some children, and he had gone to a class which had a lot of kids and gave a bowl of toffees like this and kind of gave this kind of thing and said, okay, everyone can have one, right? But if you wait for 2 hours or 1 hour or something like that, you can have two. So immediately, you know, kids rushed and took it. Who there wants two later on? Take one now. But there were some kids who didn't do that. And he was very interested. He noted that and he did a longitudinal study on those guys. About 40 years later, he went and see what these guys are doing. He traced those guys. He actually did it. The guy who died when he was 19 or so, he had enough of time to do that. And he found that those guys were better off in their jobs and things like that than some of those other guys. So that thing is a very important thing. Actually, this sacrificing resources now for a better tomorrow is a very important thing. We are actually talking about the historical because they have some relevance now. We have to look at the what does it mean for an organization now. What do these mean for an organization now? So these are also very important. Also this idea about the future and the present, which I mentioned at the beginning, this is a role that everyone has to do. You have to efficiently manage your resources now. That is management. But leadership is thinking about the future and leading and adapting and evolving. Three ways of, sometimes if the environment is so difficult, you can't challenge the environment, you adapt. Darwinian theory, basically Charles Darwin identified that why we have evolved, according to him, is because we were more adaptable. Then when the environments changed, we adapted ourselves. And whatever animals that are existing now, they adapted. And they adapted, like for example, according to Darwinian theory, why a giraffe has a long neck or something like that is due to adaptation. Then the trees grew taller over many millions of years, the giraffe's neck also grew longer. And this was aptly found out in a particular place called the Galapagos Islands. Two islands where they had two those massive tortoises. One island, the tortoise had a longer neck. That's because the vegetation had changed to be shrubs and not ground level. Over thousands of years, see what happens is every tortoise has the same length. So you'll find that the guys who have longer will survive. And their offsprings will also have longer necks. And so on and so forth. The distribution changes and you find that the adaptation takes place like that. So what is the lessons are lessons for organizations. Sometimes a leader shouldn't challenge the market forces. The market forces are very powerful. So then he must adapt sometimes. But there is another, while Darwin said that, there was another adaptation guy called Singer. He said that by challenging the environment. You hammer the environment and then you evolve. So now what people are doing is they are hammering the environment, basically. Right? So we are supposed to survive like that. Very good. Anyway, So this is very important. Sometimes this word leader comes from the Latin word for leader is lugo. So therefore this also gives an idea for leadership, that is that you have to educate. Educate does not mean lecturing or anything like that. It means training, it can be development and do things like that. So the moment you do that, you are taking people forward. So the focus on, very important focus for leadership development today in organizations is leadership development. And leadership development focuses on stages of development of people. We come to that in the next thing, where we, how do you do that? How do you do that, and how do you really take people on different levels? Mental levels. This mental level is a very important thing. So this subject, actually what we are going to talk about, has two sides. One is leadership, other one is business development. So businesses also have to evolve, and they're understand by leaders. So we are focusing on those two areas. So we will be from time to time talking about leadership or business development. Sometimes we are talking about business models. Then we are talking about mental models. Leader's mental model and business model. If the business model has to be more sophisticated, the leader's mental model also has to be more sophisticated. So these go side by side. You can't have a very basic leader trying to lead a sophisticated organization. It won't fit. Same time, sometimes you might get a very good technically sound guy, he becomes a CEO and he can't lead. Because his mental model is not suited at that level. He may be very good at one level, but so his development has not taken place. So we have to very carefully focus on how to do that, how to develop people as well. Some practical stuff is here. Okay. This is some lessons from even in Buddhism. You have a sutta called the Lakkhana Sutta. Right? It means some signs that if a person has those signs, something like 37 signs. 37? 32. Yeah, 32 signs, sorry. 32 signs. Either he could be a Chakravarti or a Buddha. That's the whole idea about that. So it was one of the earliest trait theories. Traits. And in fact, this book, if you can get, it's written by our Chancellor. When you come for the convocation, you will get the convocation from him. He is Reverend Dr. Bellangila Vimalaratna, the Chancellor of Sri Javadhanapura University. His PhD thesis was deciphering the Lakkhana Sutta. So the book is named, generally called the Mahapurusha concept. He has translated that into English. He wrote it in English in the London University, I think. That's where he got his PhD. And it's very useful to study leadership. On one side is the Lakkhana Sutta, is one of the suttas. It says that there are some signs, and if those signs are seen, you can predict that this person is a leader. Or it might either if he chooses, he could be a monarch or a Buddha, either case. Right. So, if you read these things, sometimes you know there is concern about leadership. Some of those things, what Reverend Bellangila Vimalaratna did was, he deciphered those things. The way it's written is, it's encrypted. Encrypted means it's not easily written. Like for example, it says that one of the signs is he has feet spreading backwards also. Now you can't have a person having feet spreading backwards, no? So when he deciphered, he went back into the Pali and tried to understand what it really meant. It means this. That is, now for example, if someone comes and pushes you from behind, you won't fall because your feet are forward. But if someone comes and pushes you from front, you will fall. There is no support. So it says that if there are feet protecting backwards, no one can drop you. You can stand erect. Vattanna vay. person who cannot be dropped, psycho, mentally or physically, either case. So that's a simple deciphering. But if you read that book, actually it was a very interesting book. He had gone back to the old Pali, not the Pali that you know now, the ancient Pali, and he had deciphered that. So that took a lot of work, I think. So he got a PhD for that. So anyway, he was very happy when he heard that I am talking about this in the class. It is not necessarily a religious thing, but it says that you need this kind of leadership abilities even if you want to be a Buddha, right? So this is very interesting. So this is also on the sutras. Now this is Aristotle's famous model. Aristotle, of course, as you know, was the advisor to Alexander the Great. And he was also a soldier during his days, and he could advise. But as you know, these soldiers, when they get older, they become very wise also. So all their ideas about war and things like that, they can give some advice. He gave a very simple model. This is actually from his, Aristotle wrote a book called Rhetoric. And he was mainly focusing on when you try to communicate with people, that you need to use three very important dimensions when you want to communicate. But the fact is, the leaders communicate to their people, and when they communicate, they tell these very important factors, the ethos, the pathos and the logos, those are Greek words. Aristotle was a Greek. Has a lot of meaning. For example, ethos means, the English word that comes from that is ethics. Very often leaders fail because they don't have good ethics. Their ethics fail. They may be very good strategists. They may be very good people who can convince other people, like Hitler, for example. German guys are very difficult to be moved by emotion. They are very masculine, so-called masculine guys, no? They even call their country, one of the few guys who call their country fatherland. Everyone else calls their country motherland. German guys call their country fatherland. So you can imagine. So they don't look at their country as a mother, they look at their country as a father. Right? So it's very... So Hitler changed those fellows' ideas, but he was wrong. Where did he go wrong? Ethics. Basically, ethically, he was trying to do a wrong thing. He was trying to purify the human race by destroying some races. Kill the Jews and the Poles and people like that to try to eliminate bad traits in human beings. Actually, this is very funny. And he was led by a theory that was written at that time called the Aryan supremacy theory, which was a theory. It was not a practically proved thing. That there is a thing called Aryan supremacy. So he started destroying all the people who identified as not Aryans. So, but people following him, educated people actually who were in the universities were taken off, and they were given special title as Schutzstaffel, SS guys. And even those guys didn't challenge Hitler, but when they, over a period of time, when they realized what they were doing, they started, the SS guys started slashing their own wrists. Famous, they sort of slashed their wrists and committed suicide when they realized what they were doing. So it was evil. So evil kind of leadership. So ethos is a very important thing. Pathos is the English word that comes from that is empathy. As I mentioned, empathy is not sympathy. Not anukampa. More kind of anukampane, like kind of thing, you know. Sorry, is that the correct word? I don't know. That means you can understand the other person, but you may not agree. You may not have that point of view, but you can understand a person. So that is, today we normally leave that into emotional intelligence. Ability to understand another person's point of view. Empathy is a very important dimension of emotional intelligence. And then, logos, the word that comes from, English word that comes from logic. That is, they must be able to plan, strategy. There is a logic in what they are doing. There is strategy. Strategy is a logic. And that can be explained. If you have a logic, you can explain that logic and people will understand that, why you are doing something. So, these three dimensions are still very important. You know, why I am showing you this, if you want to, sometimes this leadership writings of people like Robin Sharma. You come across Robin Sharma, actually. He has a book that's written called The Saint, the Surfer and the CEO. That is a remake of this model, actually. What he has in that book, his books are like stories, actually. There is this particular guy who meets with an accident. Yeah, you read the book?
No, not really. Yeah. I read some of the other articles of
him. Yeah, quite good, actually. He takes his old thinking and puts it into modern context, and they are stories because they are true. This particular guy in his story meets with an accident and he ends up unconscious in a hospital, and he wakes up. And when he wakes up, there is another guy who is a terminal patient. He's going to die, an old guy. The old guy gets friendly with him and says, okay, I will do, now I'm going to die, so I will help you out, you're going to live. So he says, there are three people I want to introduce you to. You have to somehow go and meet them. So this whole story is about that. So the first person is a priest in Rome. The ethos aspect comes on that, and that's generally referred to as the saint. The saint. Then you have the surfer. He's a guy who, another guy he wanted to meet is a surfer in Hawaii. The surfers, you know, what he wanted to get from that guy was the emotional aspect. Why is he surfing? Why is he doing this kind of thing? Why does he take a risk? All that kind of thing is an emotional thing. Why you take a risk is an emotional thing. So to learn that part of it, which reflects onto the pathos, right? And then he said to go and meet a CEO in Manhattan Island, in New York, who is very successful. And the whole idea he'll tell you what strategy and things like that. And that is the CEO. So this entire book that he has written is a remake of Aristotle's. So you see, what happens is there is still a lot of truth in that. Those things, they are fundamental things about leadership, which are important to know, background. So what we need to understand is, how do you do this in a setup? How do you do this? There are different setups. Say the workplace setup, the home setup, okay. How do you use ethos, pathos and logos at home? Okay, very important thing. With kids, for example. With the wife is a little different from that. Okay, so anyway, this is Aristotle. We are on a historical model thing. Must do something about this thing. Okay, now this is a small clip explaining Aristotle, the whole principle of Aristotle's thinking about how he influenced Alexander the Great. Where basically, if you read that rhetoric, you will find that there are 10 basic behaviors which reflect these three things, these three ethos, pathos and logos, and that is action, intention, commitment, self-discipline, gentleness, guidance, kindness, consideration, honesty. 10 behaviors which are very, very important if you are trying to bring Aristotle's thinking into the workplace.
We are all apprentices of one kind or another, and can point to significant individuals in our lives that have played the role of mentor, teacher, and guide. Think of professors, relatives, primary school teachers, co-workers, and friends. Apprenticeships always occur within a personal relationship with one or more masters. These masters act as mentors as knowledge is passed on from one to the other. They guide as they lead, they teach as they mentor, they model as they act. Aristotle probably couldn't have imagined the role he would play in the life of Alexander the Great. Alexander went on to rule much of the modern world of the time. His influence was far-reaching, and the impact of Aristotle's mentoring in his life will never be fully realized. When we think of Alexander, we don't normally think of him as an apprentice. We think of a ruler, a leader, and a man of great power and authority, perhaps even a mentor in his own right. Yet he, too, was guided. Alexander was a nuanced and complex soul. He was perceptive, logical, and calculating. He had a great desire for knowledge and a deep love of philosophy. Alexander was an avid reader and was fascinated by wonder. This was no doubt in part to his tutelage by Aristotle. Without a doubt, no paradigm exists to fully describe and explain the mentor-mentee relationship. Models, structures, and step-by-step systems may ultimately restrict. However, I would like to offer 10 key words for your consideration as you mentor others and thereby lead your organization. Action. Intention, commitment, self-discipline, gentleness, guidance, kindness, consideration, honesty, relationship. We must remain open to the relationships around us as we seek to situate our mentees in a world that is grounded yet filled with opportunities to grow and learn more. We mentor the new, the young, and the inexperienced, showing them what to expect and how to navigate in these new worlds. Plant some seeds in the lives of others, but don't neglect the watering of your own. Our life in the professional world is a long series of teachable moments. Grounded in relationship, guided by experience, and gifted with insight, we build, we act, we grow. If we don't mentor, if we choose not to pass on our ideas, our strengths, and our shared collective wisdom, what then? Experience and the lessons learned will be lost in time, like tears in the rain.
Okay. Last time, I think most of you came to Colombo, and W.A. Vijayavadana was talking about Kautilya, and he said that I am the one who talks about Kautilya in the class and declares. So it's very useful reading Kautilya's Arthashastra. Arthashastra is actually statecraft. And he was the advisor to King Chandragupta Maurya. Very powerful king actually at that time. His mantra about like these models, if you are still talking about old ancient models about leadership, is this famous action model. In other words, how do you deal with issues and things like that? That's what he's talking about here. What he's talking about is the process of doing something. Very simple idea is that if you have an issue or some problem to solve, how do you solve that problem? So he says, first look at Sama. Now we use this word Samadhana as peace, but it's a very much more deeper meaning word. Sama means equity. See whether there is some inequity among the setup. That is, for example, in an organization, say salary, pay distribution or something like that, or resource distribution, or something like that, where there is inequity. So if that is very easy to solve, if there is inequity and you can understand that's because of that inequity, it's not inequality, inequity. Equity is you give a person something he's due. That's what equity is. So when there is something where his due is not given, so solve it out. Then the second stage, if you can't solve it, that then give something, dana. Give something. Now those are very peaceful ways of solving problems. But there are some problems that you go beyond that. Then you go to the Veda. Veda is actually argue with the guys, explain, or create sometimes in a very controversial way, create positive conflict. There is positive conflict and negative conflict. Right? You can have two sides, and get people to argue, and then suddenly the truth comes out. So that is Veda. And if everything fails, you hammer. That is danda, punishment. So go at the last resort is, sometimes people go to the last resort first. But what this advice is, go in stages. But while you are doing that, he says that a leader also should have some behavioral aspects, create some kind of illusion about something, which can be visions or something like that. So you have to be capable of doing that. The way you communicate things, show a better future sometimes, things like that. Upeksha is a, you have to stand aside from, don't take sides or anything like that, and that's what it's meant here. Upeksha has so many meanings, but in this case what was mentioned that you actually don't take a side as such, you have to be non-attached and things like that. And try to create some magic. Sometimes people can't understand why things go right. They say this guy has some, everything he does comes right and things like that. But it's a well thought of strategies. So you, for the person who sees it, it looks like magic. But leaders also have to be capable of doing that, to create illusions, to create some kind of magic. They say only if you do it, it happens kind of thing, you know, that kind of thing. If you go and talk to those guys, it will work out. So you need to have that magic in your hand, you know, the ability. Sometimes I can remember when I was an engineer, I used to go and solve problems. There was some problem that was, I told you about this, I don't know, which there was a time I was installing these microwave towers. And one of those towers was in a place called Belungala. Did I tell you about that? Okay, so Belungala was a famous, one of the smaller towers. I was the project manager for all those microwave towers, the Colombo, Belungala, Laggala, Kirimatiyakanda, Vavuniya, Trincomalee, Jaffna, the installation of those towers, I was doing that. So the Belungala tower was only 75 feet because there was a big hill and very easy to do that. But the people who were in the surrounding, they were not easy guys. They were of a particular type of people, and even the police didn't go to mess around with those. So when we went to install this tower, the police warned us, saying be careful of those guys, because if they kill someone, no one goes to solve that problem. It's so bad. So I took my gang and went and I warned the fellows and said, don't go, because I know what the gangs do. They go behind those girls and things like that in those villages, right? So I warned the guys, this place, don't try anything like that. So supervisor was there, and I go on the weekends only, go and check everything. So one day I get a call suddenly that one of our riggers, fellows of crime thing, is in the hospital, critically injured. So I went there. See what had happened, ultimately to find out what had happened, was the supervisor was getting involved with a girl in that site. And this rigger looks like him. So he has taken that girl and gone off. And the father of the girl stabbed the rigger, thinking that that's a guy. So the rigger had lost his eye also. The eye was also lost. Big problem. The police did not want to go and mess around with those guys. So eventually I went and spoke to the father. So what else to do? I have to finish the job also. So and then ultimately with the help of our HR guy also, we promised to bring that girl back. So fellows brought the girl back, and all this. Ultimately that guy got married to that girl. That was a long story, the long part of the story. But the fact is that the father allowed us to finish the installation. So the fact is that, I don't know, somehow or the other I went and spoke to that father. So I don't think I have the talent like that now, but those days I had that talent, you know. So I think you have to create that, you have to create an illusion. After that, of course, everyone used to come with me to work on projects and things like that. You know, so once you create that kind of illusion that you can do things and, you know, you can talk to people, save people. So that's I think very important. This is Kautilya's, it's called a craft. Kautilya looked at leadership as a craft. You know what a craft is? Craft is a kind of a thing like an art. So, interesting reading Kautilya. If you read Kautilya, of course. So, what I'm trying to do, I'll see going very slowly on this thing is also, because there's a lot of ancient stuff that we can look into modern context. What does it mean? So, very often people do research into these ancient documents and try to see, okay, people have not changed very much for the last 3,000 years. Although we know technology and all those things and we are a little different socially, psychologically we are the same. We have not changed very much for the last so many years. These guys wrote about people who are like us, you know. So, when you work in organizations, these things come to play. Your leadership is a behavior. It is mainly a behavior. You know, always remember that. It's a behavior. You can learn that behavior. Or sometimes you're born with that behavior. Sometimes you're born in the sense that your parents have taught you that. And your school has given you some ideas and things like that. But whoever has not been given that can be developed. That is the management idea. So we have to know how to do that. Yeah. Okay, this is you can't avoid talking about Japanese guys. Because what happens is, if you look at the typical Bushido, which is really, we are talking about the samurai guys. Samurai. They were the soldier class in Japan. Very important about that is that they have the belief that even a very, very weak guy would be developed into a samurai by developing certain behaviors. Only he will take a longer time. Have you seen that film, The Last Samurai? That is built on that idea that you can even person has a different idea, you over a period of time and very rigorous kind of discipline, you can turn a person into a samurai. That's a very good idea for management. That is, by certain competencies, in our context, that language we talk now, competencies, you can make a person a good leader, if he is not a leader at all. So this is a very important thing. So Bushido is the culture. It was called the culture of the samurai. And some of the behavioral aspects are shown here. These are seven aspects. Let me explain about this. Rectitude. Rectitude means to stand straight. If you have some idea mentally, don't change it. If you are really believing something, don't change it. That's rectitude. Be firm. That ability is a very important ability for leadership according to the samurai. Courage. Don't be afraid to do something. Courage. Have courage. Also, benevolence is look for the good side. Respect. Respect people. Respect whoever. Respect the enemy. Honesty. Honesty is very important. Honor. Honor is you maintain the status. The status that should be there. Right? Give people also honor. And loyalty. The word loyalty is a difficult word, because what it means, that who are you loyal to? Basically, you need to know whom you need to be loyal to, and therefore don't change it. That's the whole idea. So these are very simple things, no? They are not very big things. But how the samurai train these are very important. These guys went through hell sometimes to learn how to keep these things. So they had to walk miles, they had to put their hands into very hot sand and things like that. They must learn martial arts, because martial art means you don't give up. The rectitude thing comes from that. You don't give up, but at the same time you respect your opponent while you're doing that. Very difficult to understand that. And the whole idea about martial arts is to put mind before body, not body before mind. So you, while something is coming, you should be able to immediately make a choice before the, say if you're using a pole or something like that and use that, or even the karate blow, before it hits you, you must realize what to do with it. So that's the part of kind of discipline is very important. So this Bushido moved into Zen. Zen is a philosophy, and from that you have Kaizen and things like that which came out of that, which is so we are now talking about these things, and now we must jump about, come to what you call modern theories of see, the idea about leadership started by MBA guys in 1950, the universities, not universities, actually, universities didn't do MBAs. Most of the institutes like Caltech, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, they were institutes, they're not universities. They're institutes, but they're affiliated to universities. They started teaching management as a science. That's where it started in the West. So one of the important things was they focused on management, but eventually they realized that future is very important, and that how do you lead people into the future. So the study of leadership started in the 1950s or so. The psychologists came into the scene at that time, and that helped them to understand the psyche of the leader. Some of these, how we developed, the leadership study developed is in stages. For example, in the 1955 or so, this famous Kurt Lewin model, which says that if you are a leader, there were three styles, which are autocratic, that is people, he's one rule. What I say, you need to do, kind of thing, very autocratic. They have been successful, actually. Some of the autocratic leaders are very successful. Democratic means you ask others, what do you think? What should we do? Take a vote or something like that. That's what you call democracy. No? Democracy doesn't work always, but anyway, sometimes some leaders who are democratic came out with good results. Or laissez-faire is actually came out of the French Revolution long time ago, where people were allowed to do what they want. You know what happened, no? The monarchy was thrown out. That was the end of the monarchy in the French Revolution. They killed the king, and they even invented a machine to slice the head off, the guillotine. Right? And people were doing it. People were mad. Actually, there were no other people to tell what they were doing. Some organizations also are like that, and they are successful sometimes. So it doesn't mean to say that you have to be autocratic, you have to be democratic, or you have to be. So it's very interesting to understand how this happened. But they said that if you are, very important thing, it's either or. If you are autocratic, you can't be democratic. That was the idea. If you are democratic, you can't be anything. If you are laissez-faire, then you are laissez-faire type of leader, allowing people to do what they want. So they started by saying that there are three types. But what really happened was, when they went on studying this, so let me show you that on a diagram actually. So the first studies on leadership says you could be either autocratic, you could be democratic, or you could be laissez-faire. So there was no connection between this. You either this or that. That's why they studied them as different things. They were not interested in developing leaders. They only said that some people were successful and either they were autocratic, democratic or laissez faire. So then what happened was, by about 1965 or so, this Tannenbaum and Schmidt model tried to say that it is possible that it's a continuum, that between autocratic and democratic, you can be sometimes autocratic, sometimes democratic. So that is, a person could have both these abilities. Say sometimes he could be autocratic, but on other times he could be democratic. And also they said, okay, 80% of the time a person is autocratic, 30%, 20% of the time he may be democratic, or along that continuum it can be 50-50, it can be anything else. So they realized that sometimes a leader is autocratic, sometimes is democratic. So it was a more on a statistical kind of thing that you say that it's possible to be this song. A person could be described as 80% autocratic, 20% democratic, something like that. This idea came in 1960s or so. Then by about 1970s, they defined the model even further, and they said you could be highly autocratic or highly democratic also. That's very funny. That is, immediately, these are actually, the whole idea is focusing on Cartesian or these famous X and Y things, X, Y. You could be anywhere here in a X, Y plane. So someone here could have, say for example, here the dimensions are not autocratic and democratic, but say for example, concern for people and concern for task. A person could be put on a two-dimensional thing, so therefore you could have a locus. This was the first attempt to try to train people to be leaders by first measuring where they are now. Sometimes you might get very good, technically strong guys who are not very good with people. So they might be somewhere here or something, concern for task is very good, but low concern for people. At the same time, you get very popular leaders, they are very good with people, but nothing much effort is happening. They are not all that great with task. So if you can measure a person, that is the idea, at this on this plane, you could now move the guy to some place you want. So that was the first beginning of that, and what came out of that was this famous managerial grid 1978-79 or so, to say that you could look at concern for people, concern for production, and this became a measure, first measure of measuring leadership. One of the first measures to measure a person's leadership. Leadership became a measurable thing as such, because if you have Cartesian dimensions, these are Cartesian dimensions, two dimensions, you could even create a third dimension you want, say concern for culture or something like that. It is more complex, but the fact is that this Cartesian thing helped people to use it as a tool. So if you can identify a person and locate a person, say for example somewhere here, and this had a 9x9 kind of matrix. It was based on a questionnaire. So a person answers this questionnaire, and based on that, he can be located on this thing as highly democratic. Is not more, no democratic, autocratic, but more kind of concern for people, concern for task. So the fact is that ideal is to be high concern for people and high for task. That is why you are supposed to be a really good leader. That is, he can get the results, at the same time he can get the results through people, I would say. Very important thing. So, how can this be used as a training tool? Say for example, you measure a person somewhere here, say he is a 4-2 manager. 4-2 manager, okay. That's a leader, 4-2 leader. That is 4 high on production. So what do you first do? He is very high on production. Say 4 is high on production. but he's low on people. So what you do is you train him with soft skills. Soft skills are focusing on people, like communication, ability to, I would say, inspire, right? Emotional intelligence, all those are soft skills. So he doesn't need any more hard skills. So his training now is to try to get him onto this line, this diamond, this line of equality, which ultimately ends in, and slowly then bring him there. Now if you get a guy who is really popular type of leader, people like him, but not so great on results, then you give him some hard skills. He's lacking in hard skills. But his people skills are good. So you see, suddenly it becomes a measurable thing. We are moving into managing leadership now, like kind of trying to develop leaders. So 1970s was a period where this was trying to be used. And the tools that they used were things like this. So this is the managerial bit. They can move on. We have break, no? So shall we take the break? Summarize what we have been talking about is we were talking about a lot of models, some ancient models, modern models, and we are going to talk about what we call postmodern models also, things of that will be required for the future to think about leadership. Each of these models, they don't compete against each other, they can be used for different purposes. So the ancient models, you normally have to revisit to see what is the modern application. Always there is a modern application, because people have not changed as such, although their techniques and things are as natural. As a human being, we are still the same. So therefore, you can, only times have changed, so you need to bring it to modern times. Some of these models are very practical, the modern ones. For example, this model that we just spoke of can be used. So if you feel that people, you want to assess a person's leadership ability, you can use this. In fact, how you do it is, there is a questionnaire, you can download it from the web, it's freely available. It's called the Blake and Morton questionnaire. You give it to people and they will answer, and then you fix them on this, and then you know exactly what is the training you have to give. Sometimes you have to give hard skills, sometimes you have to give soft skills. Very often organizations make the mistake of taking everyone for certain skills. You can save a lot of time and money, and also get better outcomes if you know exactly what is the type of training you have to give people, and focus on individual to individual rather than group. Because it may be a waste of teaching, say for example, emotional intelligence to people who are anyway emotional intelligent. So it's a waste of time and money also. So, and also you are not going to get an output of that, because the guy is already good. But sometimes a very emotionally intelligent guy might not be able to give results. Just in being emotionally intelligent, you must need technique as well. So sometimes you give the technique then. So you it actually, suddenly now you be focusing on people individually. Okay, here's another. So far we are talking about two-dimensional models. This next model is a multi-dimensional model. Anyway, this is normally used for training. For training or coaching, where you are looking at the leader on one side, and here you have leader's behavior as supportive. Supportive means people-oriented behavior. As on the other side, directive. Directive is supervisional, structural kind of behavior that a leader, two types of behaviors that a leader should have. Again, we are going on to focus on people, focusing on tasks. Now, on the other side, now you introduce them, the follower. The follower can be, for example, if you are doing a training, the people who are being trained, other followers. He is a leadership event. We are training, is a leadership event. We are trying to train people. But the same behavior, so you want to know what kind of behavior the leader should do depending on the level of the followers' maturity. How do you measure the followers' maturity? On two dimensions, commitment and competence. Commitment is whether they like the thing and they are really crazy about doing what they want to, that's commitment. Competent is, can they do it? Now, a good example, if I take a very simple example to demonstrate this, is like, for example, you're teaching someone to drive a car. Okay. That's a leadership thing. You are taking him to the future. So when you start, let's see now, if you start, look at the followers' behavior at the beginning, say this person who wants to learn to drive the car has high commitment but low competence, can't drive. Now what is the behavior the leader should do? If you do that, you just project this upwards and into this square, and you will find that he should give a lot of structure and not be so supportive also. At the beginning, this model says don't be very supportive but more focus on structure. Give tasks. Sometimes you need to also be tough at that time. You know, this is what you have to do. But after some time, you will find, how do you know that the follower's maturity has changed? This is the second stage. His commitment is low. Earlier it was high, now it is low. Why is it low? Sometimes when you try to learn something, you get little fed up with the thing. There is a space, time where you get, say, why am I doing this kind of, I hope the MBA program is not like that. Right? Do you feel that about it? So then the leader has to have a different behavior. Okay. But the competency medium. Now, earlier it was low, this guy can drive the car now. He can take the car onto the road and go a little bit. So, what is the behavior that the leader should do? Now, just project it upwards and you come to this square. Now, he should have high, still high directive behavior and also high supportive. A new thing has come in, now he has to encourage. Say, why not? Do it. It's not a big thing to do. It's very simple. You can do it. Focus on his capability and give him a lot of support. That behavior is not there earlier, but it, because it was not needed at the beginning. Now that behavior comes in. And then you go to, then you take the guy to the third level, where his commitment now has come up, it's medium. Competence is high, he can do it. What is the type of behavior the leader should have? You direct this upwards and you come to this square. He should have high supportive, but not so much directive. He drops his directive side, because this guy can drive now. He doesn't say, okay, do this, turn right and things like that. Why don't you use the other kind of gear if you are using manual or something like that? He says, no, you can give no more direction. Only support. Come on, you can do it. So you suddenly drop the other behavior. And finally, you find that you have led him to be high commitment and high competence as well. What is your behavior? Just leave off. No supportive, no directive, not necessary. This is actually generally referred to as the Hersey and Blanchard situational model. Situation is, what is the behavior, what the situation here is, the maturity of the follower. So which means to say that you don't have to use, if you look at this behavior and you are having a group of people, you must immediately know what are the levels of maturity. And depending on the level of the maturity, your behavior should be different for each person. Some people you should be tough, some people you should be cool, and things like that. Some people so it all depends on these dimensions. This is a four-dimensional model. Two-dimensional for the leader, two-dimensional for the follower. Very useful. In the sense that, I mean, if you look at a good leader, he doesn't have the same behavior with everyone. I don't like to talk about Arjuna Ranatunga as a politician, but as a cricketer, super cricketer. The time we won the World Cup and all, I told you, I brought him to class one day and he spoke about leadership and things like that. He said the same thing. He said there are some people, you have to be very tough. Hey, some people, if you like Aravinda Silva and Muralidharan, if you shout at the fellows for about 2 weeks, they don't talk to you. That's what you are saying. Because those guys are competent people. No need of telling them what to do. But you were saying about Pushpa Kumar. Yeah, Pushpa Kumar used to whirl one ball and fully out. Then he goes and puts his hand on the guy. Now the crowd thinks that this guy is, pacifying him or something like that. He's saying he gives the best language. Then the next ball is right on the target. So different people, you can't treat everyone the same. So you see, that's called situational leadership. You have the situation is actually only this situation of the follower. And the leader changes his style. Of course, here we are talking about two styles. We are quite good, supportive and directive. On the other side, you look at the, how do you know where you should, how, what the model you should use? By measuring the leadership maturity on two dimensions. Whether this guy is keen, or whether he is actually, this is also called skill and will. Whether you have the will and whether you have the skill. So this is a very useful model actually, especially when you want to take a person to another level of competence. From one level to another competence, you are leading him here, yeah, leadership behavior. Take off. Okay, I actually, this is a tsunami scene, which we all worked in the tsunami, and we learned a lot of things about leadership there. Because there were some type of leaders who were not designed to be leaders. They suddenly emerged from the crowd. A group of emergent leadership. I am talking about this when I talk about the disaster management setup, the time that I talk about that. When I presented a paper after that in South Africa, I used this model, I made this model, and I found that there were, how I could describe the leaders who were there at that time is only this way. Like for example, some of the leaders were assigned, that is the Grama Niladharis and the people who anyway had a position to do leadership, assigned leaders, were there. Sometimes their entire mechanism was damaged, in the sense that the officers were damaged, they couldn't function as leaders because they didn't have the data. But luckily, this is a human thing, you get people who emerge, sometimes from the grassroots, you know. From nowhere people come and do a lot of good work. We discovered people like that and we named them. Of course, there is a study on emergent leadership, especially in disasters, you get a lot of people who come in like that. At the same time, the behavior of these leaders could be either transactional or transformational. Transactional means using good rules and regulations and doing things, using transactions. But they are not very inspirational and all. They will tell you what to do, but they will take you from one point to another. But you get another set of people who are really charismatic and, you know, who are major personalities, and when they see things, people immediately, those are transformational leaders. So I found there were among four activities that were there. Like for example, community project management. That is, you want people to come in and you organize people from nowhere and do things. Right? Like Shramadana kind of thing, but on a bigger scale sometimes. They are the emergent leaders and were very good, but what the emergent leaders, they were transactional, they were not transformational. They were very transactional. Particularly one of the experiences I had there, which was two of our students actually, well, you know this background to our tsunami work, no? When the tsunami struck, it was December 2004, and we had prepared students to do their research. I can remember Professor Lienage and I addressed the students and got them to bring their research proposals next in January, the next January that was coming. But before January, you know what happened? The tsunami struck. So we went, after about 7 days, we went to see what had happened as a group of faculty. About 7 days, about 1 week later, and we were wondering what to do. Suddenly with the idea came that why don't we change all these researchers into tsunami projects? That's the first time we started doing skills projects. Before that, we had not done it. What's the point of being a management faculty if we can't do something there? So the thing we immediately saw was camp management. From the camp management, we went on to temporary houses. From temporary houses, we went on to permanent houses. from permanent houses, we started doing business. I was leading that part of it. We developed 60 small businesses. Very interesting, right? So the guys who did it were two students, couples of students who did that, and supervisor, of course. And so we had a lot of ideas about VI. One particular area which I'm talking about, this community project management, was two of our students were working in the Koggala bus stand was converted to a temporary kind of shelter. You can't, no air is blowing and all those things there, so we were trying to do some. And they were working with the JVP guys. JVP guys were the main fellows who were doing that. So our people were two guys were very keen to go and work with them. So we said, okay. So I was the supervisor. So tsunami guy, the students learnt a lot of politics at the end of that. And JVP guys learnt a lot of management. So because good knowledge. So from the bus, Koggala bus depot, they moved to temporary houses. Now we had our own design. Dr. A.K. Jayawardhan, you know, and I designed actually the house, how to make a. So we had our design, but the JVP guys said they have their design, they want to do that. Their design was like a wadiya, long thing like this, separated. Actually, technically, it's a better design because less materials and you can do it very fast. So our guys also said, let's do it. So next, about 2 weeks later, I went there and the houses were up and people were there and big fight there. So the two JVP guys were waiting like this. Our people were smiling and waiting. So the JVP guys say, mum duppatu natu mother, Dhanapati adahasti enu nisu. What had happened was, see, technically it was a good solution, but socially it was not a good solution. What had happened was, one house, now that was the first step to bring the family together. One family had washed clothes, washed vegetables and thrown it, and the next, on the next people had put clothes to dry. So a big fight. Actually, they could share responsibility and there's a terrific fight. So anyway, what I'm trying to say is that, the way the JVP guys and our guys worked on that thing was, I would say, very structural. The way they did it, no inspiration, but real rules and regulations and doing the thing. Within 1 week, they had made the wadiya. How they made the wadiya was amazing, actually, amazing. So anyway, what happened was, that was transactional, but done by the emergent leaders. Now, there was another group, like, for example, emergency grassroots organization. There were places like this, which were, this is a snapper I took. These people had lost their house. So, there was a problem about ownership. Who owns this thing? So what happened is, that was not JVP guys, but another set of emergent leaders, they knew the background to this. For years they have been in that place. They could tell the history of this place. So in the absence of any deeds or anything like that, a lot of people were repositioned into places which are totally damaged because of the grassroots guys saying that this really happened. So a thing like the transformation from a bad situation to a good situation. The assigned leaders are the Gramani Dadaris and the police guys and the school people are assigned leaders, the principals. They also were transactional sometimes when they got funding from government to do set it back again. There was regular funding. So they did it properly like projects. So that is a real project management, no inspiration. But they have transformation also. Recovery management. Recovery is actually, how do you do things? There were a lot of trauma in that area. How did they handle it? There were cases where there was one of the Gramani Dadaris, wife also had died. Tsunami, but he was there working there, you know. So that's a very, I mean, yes, forgot that was not there now, and he was trying to get things back again. So that was not his official duty. Especially everyone is here, go and look after your family or something like that. But there was behavior like that. So this is sometimes when we want to explain something, a thing like this, there is no, now this I made. So you also can make things like this. If you can get two dimensions of behaviors and an event, you should be able to understand what really happened by pitching types of leadership to explain certain different behaviors in a situation. It's complex. So that is a two dimensional. By the way, I solved that problem. Simple thing, as you said, I just knocked off the this is one of this modern thinking is Stephen Covey's. Stephen Covey actually is a famous guy who wrote about Seven Habits, saying that if you want to be spiritually, if you want to be a leader, you need to have seven habits. Right? A leader. If you want to be a leader, you can, and anyone can get habits. You know how to get a habit from? Or if you don't, sometimes I have a habit of drinking 600 milliliters of water in the morning. In the beginning, very difficult. But after some time, it automatically happens. Your body will go and you will, driving a car for example, when you're learning, you are very conscious about what this is and all that. But now today you can have a chat with people and you can drive the car. That's a habit. So you can create habits. What Stephen Covey said is, just seven habits, you can become a very effective person. You remember the word effectiveness is a leadership behavior. Efficiency is a manager's behavior. Efficiency is a leader. He has to be, not necessarily, a leader need not be efficient. His main task is to be effective. But among those tasks, one is to manage his own people. Those are the guys who should be efficient. So indirectly, he is looking after efficiency, but not directly. Say for example, if you want to win a war, whoever is leading the war has to win the war at any cost. At any cost. At any cost, when you say any cost, that is efficiency. But the guys on the ground have to be efficient so that they do things so that they don't lose people, they don't lose ground, they don't lose weapons. That is efficiency. Effectiveness is somehow. So the role of the leader is to target on effectiveness. But among his tasks of effectiveness, he has to effectively lead the people also who have to be efficient. It's not his role. He has to lead the people to be efficient. So that's indirectly. He has to be efficient, but not directly. Now what Stephen Covey says is, these seven habits will take you to three levels. You can't be a leader immediately. You have to first be a Golia, a follower, and learn very well. Under a good, you are very lucky, your boss has to be a good boss. At least good, what I mean by good, he is a good leader. If you get a good leader as a boss, that is a good start. So sometimes a very important thing is to search for a good boss and work with a good boss for some time. You will learn. So it's very important. It's almost like, see, in engineering we have these apprentice systems. Actually, if you work under very good guys, you learn the thing very well. That's very important. But you have to be very obedient at the beginning, a disciple. So you start with dependence. But you're not going to be everyday dependent. You have to be your own person. You have to be independent. Now to move from dependence to independence, there are three, according to Covey, there are three habits. One is to be proactive. That is, think before you act. That is proactive. Think before you act. If you don't think before, you are reactive. You just react, right? Now, for example, if I take this and do that, you got it, right? That's reactive, right? I just want to demonstrate how reacting is. Sorry, now no big deal about that. But he could have done a lot of other things. He could have waited with that. I thought he's not going to catch it. So I was going to say, very good, you're thinking now. Nothing he could have done is, he would have taken it and thrown it back at me. Those are thinking and doing things. So you have to now, first habit is to every time think before you do something. It sounds very simple, but the fact is, you have to stop the reaction. You have to stop the reaction. Now you can't do that when you're playing cricket. No time to think whether you're going to slip something, or you think, should I catch this ball or not? that is crazy. But generally, if someone who you don't like comes and tells you something, you will react, right, immediately. So if you say, oh, no, let me see what this person is going to say now, and depending on what he says, I will do that. So you have to, like the martial arts guys, you take a deep breath and hold it. Then you can't say anything, no? Then you wait a little. Immediately your neocortex takes over, because our neocortex is a rational thing. It doesn't, reaction is from the subcortex, our old primitive brain, which is there. Sometimes you have to react, but maybe you have to practice it. So you practice it, every time you practice. They say if you practice any habit for about 2 weeks, the habit will stick to you. That's very important. So building habits is it's a purposeful thing. You have to think of it. Second habit is begin with the end in mind. That is what, when you are doing something, try to see what will be the end. Try to picture what's going to happen at the end. And then only do it. So sometimes, that's why when we do an inauguration of an MBA or something like that, we show a picture of people walking across the stage with that full kit and all those things like that. Suddenly that picture keeps sticks in the mind, and people are always, it now doesn't go off. Images actually stay in the mind. Nice faces and things like that, sometimes bad faces also, don't stay in the mind. But imagery is a very important thing. So you have to give imagery. So sometimes you have to picture what's going to, you're going to say something, you're planning to say something, you try to plan what the other person will say. So begin with the end in mind, always. So that's second habit. Third one is, put first things first. That is, you prioritize. You prioritize what you're going to do, and you live your entire life. When you're prioritizing, you don't do it only for your work. You are doing it for your private life plus the other areas also. Put everything together and plan. You can't plan only work, because other ones will interfere. So when you are planning, you prioritize the most important things. Of course, Stephen Covey talks about urgent and important. How you decide on what is urgent and what is important. And once you do that, after some time, you will find that you suddenly are a master of your own. You can manage yourself. Then you are independent. But that's not leadership. That's the first step to leadership, but not leadership. Next one is to move from independence to interdependence. That is to suddenly get the power of the other people also into your scene, somewhere or the other. That is synergy. Get others also into your track. Now how to do that is another three habits. The fourth habit is think win-win. You alone can't win. Other people also need to get returns on what they do. And how are they going to get returns? What are they going to get? Why are they doing this? What will they get? So there must be a win-win situation. Third, fifth one is, if you want to understand people, this is the emotional intelligence habit, then first understand others. That is the empathy part of it. Why a person is like that? What is his behavior? What is his psychology? What is his personality? Why does he do this thing? What is his background? If you don't know all those things, you are aware. First thing to be emotional intelligence is to be aware. So you are aware. And when you are aware, you can empathize. You can say, okay, I understand why this person is saying these things. And then you don't have to agree, but you will say something which does not hurt the guy or does not do anything like that, but might lead to a solution. That is the important thing. Finally, synergize. That is, when two people work together in the same direction, the output is greater than when they work independently. So that's this synergy thing we are talking about. But he talks about the seventh habit, and that is referred to as sharpening the saw. Why any carpenter actually always sharpens the saw before starting to work. So like that, you always return back to the other habits from time to time to see whether they have got dulled or whether they are sharp, whether you need to sharpen. So you keep going back. Because you can go back sometimes. So you don't want to go back. So you reflect on these things. Suddenly you lose your temper with one guy or something, and you, that means you have gone back a little bit. So then you have to correct that and then go back forward again. So that is called sharpening the saw. So his book actually is a very famous book, I think some of you might have read also. It's called Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, 1989. Long time ago, that's the time I did my MBA. 1989, I passed my MBA. So Stephen Covey, big news at that time. Anyway, he spoke about effectiveness and he has a nice explanation for effectiveness. He talks about a ladder, that's why I show this ladder here. They say that a good explanation, explanation for effectiveness is sometimes you might very efficiently climb a ladder, but at the end of it, when you go to the top, you find that leaning on the wrong wall. So that is not being effective. Very efficient, but not effective. Right? So therefore, this is some idea. Stephen Covey talks about being effective. Here is a more kind of project manager type of leadership model, which are three things that a project manager is also a leader, right? Very often good projects are because of good leadership. Three things to look at: the task, the individual, and the team. So we talk about the tasks. He has to negotiate goals, monitor, evaluate progress, time, cost, and quality. Basically, three things in project management that are very important: time, cost, and quality. So as such, the task is also very important. He can't deviate from any of those, all three at the same time. He has to look at. Then you have individual needs. Each of those people who work in the project have to be developed. They have a future. They are not just only parts. It's a team, also a team, not a hierarchy. Actually, if you can run an organization totally on projects, there won't be any waste. Basically, very often wastes result in organizations because they are not teams. They become hierarchies, and in hierarchies you get spots which are redundant. They are actually inert people, dead weight. But in a team, very unlikely that they are dead weight. If they are dead weight, you can see it immediately. You can eject that person if he is easily seen, and therefore you don't get inertia. If you can run an organization only on teams, if possible, it will be very successful. So therefore, the whole idea is the team leader or the project manager sees every individual very clearly, and therefore can focus on that. Then you're looking at the team itself as a group of individuals rather than individual. And three things is that the team needs to have direction. It needs to maintain cohesion, that is, connection with each other, and also that the team develops its skills as a team. So this is a famous John Adair's model of the typical a leadership model for ideally suited for project managers. As you can see, all these models cannot be used for everything. There are very particular areas where you can really use this model, and you must then use the right model when you are using it. This is for more like a HR model, I would say, and one of the main HR gurus is this Dave Ulrich. This is more suitable to really understand what are the areas that a person needs to be developed, the behavioral areas that a person needs to develop in order to be a leader. And this shows that if you are a leader, if you are ready to lead, there are two really continuums that you have to look at. One is long-term and short-term. There are some short-term things that are important, and there are some long-term things that are important. You need to identify that. At the same time, you look at each individual separately, and you look at the organization separately. So, based on that, now for example, if you look at long-term and strategic and organizational, the role of the leader is a strategist. It's long-term and organizational. So there you focus on the organization, and you focus on what the organization will be in the future. That is one role for the leader. If you're looking at long term, an individual, then you are looking at a human capital developer. Each individual has to achieve his full potential. We all have our full potential. In others, I said, for example, we know what our abilities are now. But what are our capabilities? There are so many things you can do which you don't know, actually. There are a whole lot of things, if you think of that. So therefore, the leader has to look at the individual and see something beyond what he is. That is long term. Then look at short term. Short term, he can be a talent manager. If you look at the individual, look at the individual's talent and how it can be used. Then if you look in short term and organization, every day, now this is the managerial role of the leader. Every day he has to monitor and see whether things are happening and see how things are. He should have something at, he doesn't have to go and walk around every time. But if he has some kind of information that comes and therefore he could take action, that is a short term thing. So you can see it's a very complex thing from point of view. So why it is a more like a HRD model, I would say, human resource development model, is when you are developing a leader, you have to develop these four abilities, four capabilities that are very important. Okay, here's another modern model, which is Jim Collins' famous level 5 leadership. What he says is, this is more mental model. Mental model is the way we see the world. Say, when you are a kid, you see the world in a different way. When you go to school, your mental model is different. When you get into organizations, it changes again. But within organizations, depending on the level, sometimes you can be a very, you might consider yourself a very skilled person, right? But why do a lot of skilled people fail when they become CEOs? It's because their mental model has not changed. They know that their knowledge is there, but the mental model of seeing the world as a different place it's actually a transformational thing. You have to see the world differently. This is focusing on mental models. These are mental models. Level one is highly capable individual. Second one is now he becomes can contribute to a team. Then you find that he's a competent manager, then an effective leader, and finally what you call level 5 executive. Now you can see this, descriptions also are getting more complex. At the level 1, a highly capable individual, the description is makes productive contributions through talent, knowledge, skills, and good work habits. But if you look at the level 5 executive, it's very complex. The description is also complex. Builds enduring greatness through a paradoxical combination of personal humility plus professional will. Personal humility, that is, even if you are really competent, you're a different person, you're a humble person. You're a peculiar mixture. High capable individual who is also an easy person to work with. So these are behaviors which reflect mental models needed to increasingly organizational complexity. As you go higher in organizations, you need more complex thinking. So your mental model must change. The way you see things, the way you see people, what things mean to you, they have changed. So that transformation has to occur. How does that occur? It occurs through a series of events. Through a series of events that the individual faces and reflects on it, almost like meditates on it, and then goes gradually to a higher level of understanding of situations. So that is very, it has to be consciously done mostly by the individual rather than from external source. So what really happens is, this reflection part of it becomes very important. Events that happen in daily life, you have to reflect on and try to get a meaning out of it. And that meaning you will find will change from time to time. And that kind of transformation takes you to a higher level. And that capability at that higher level is very important to organize, to manage or to lead more complex situations. So the situation that's actually in systems theory, we call it requisite variety. That is, if you are managing a complex situation, your mental model must be equally compatible with that complexity. Because a simple, a different lower level, I wouldn't like to use lower level, but a simpler mental model will try to simplify a complex situation and try to tackle it that way. So that is easily possible, and this is the whole area which leads to new levels of what you call postmodern thinking, which we are going on to here. The entire postmodern, the word postmodern means the now coming. Modern is now, but what's coming next? Like kind of thing. There are a lot of writers on this, and they are going, actually we are going back into the ancient thinking on this thing. In other words, as you improve your mental model, the way you see things, your perceptions of things and things like that, you are capable to understand more complex things. So this kind of thinking, some of the writers who have written about this are Peter Senge, Ron Heifetz, Bill Talbot. Some of the things they say, for example, what Peter Senge says is, understanding the imperatives in terms of personal development. That now the focus is on developing self. Developing self, not physically, but physically is also important, but mentally more than anything else. Cultivation of maturity, if one is in a position of authority. What Heifetz says is, what makes leadership so interesting is identifying the underlying values that can mobilize people. There are some very important values where people respond to, not commands. People don't respond to commands, but they respond to certain values in the leader. And that's very important to understand. What Talbot talks about, he uses the word metaphor. Metaphor sometimes is like this. For example, how do you see your organization? Is it like do you see it like a spaceship, or do you see it like a family, or do you see it like a psychic prison? Okay, now that's a metaphor. If you use that word to describe something, that's the metaphor. Because what Talbot says, if you identify the right metaphor, it works really well. For an organization or a situation, if you can hit on the right metaphor, then it works very well. What is it like? So it's like some natural thing. There are so many natural things. And if you can hit on that, he says that then it works. Then it works beautifully. So what he says, a metaphor is the way we ultimately capture the paradigm or frame. And the ability to catch it right is a great unlocking experience. Now I can see the language is also becoming very esoteric type of language. As you try to describe this thing, it's going more into the... Okay. What Rook talks about, another guy. Many senior managers lack the capacity to conceive, plan and implement transformational change due to they can't understand the nature of the organization, meaning-making structure. Also, this capability is, what he says is developable, but it's left to the individual. No one can do that. You have to develop yourself. That is the latest thinking about leadership. Up to a point, yes, you can bring a guy up to some point, but beyond that, you have to be on your own, and then you develop yourself. So this capacity, of course, this is very important. Okay, so this screen just shows the connection between what we have been talking about. On one side, two guys who spoke about transformational leadership is these two, Bass and Navolio. They talk about that initially for simple organizations and simple systems, you don't have to be transformational. You can, with a set of rules and work rules and standard operating procedure, you can. But if your organization is not an organization like that, it's a more complex organization, then you have to be transformational, because things are changing very fast. Transformation means change. And on the other side, if you look at this Taubert idea, Taubert is the one who's talking about, it's actually a mental model change. Typically what he talks about, some levels of mental models, like opportunist, diplomat, he's just labeling these. Experts, achievers, pluralists and strategists. As you move, developing more into self-efficacy, self-control, self-awareness and self-knowledge. Sorry. So, this is the last slide, which talks about self, basically. Tomorrow we will talk about the two assignments also. One of the assignments might be, here you need to identify some areas. You find that any our own life cycles are not one continuous growth. It's a set of cycles. You move from one stage to the other, like this, say for example. Then you leave it off and you take off with another cycle, and you take off another cycle. What they say is not to be afraid to change that cycle. Not to be afraid to take the chance and change it. Otherwise you will be on the same cycle, and if you are on the same cycle, you decay. So find help to accelerate your early learning. Start developing new skills at one point to take off for a new one. And then don't be afraid to take on this cycle. So you get virtual cycles and vicious cycle. If you stay on the same cycle, you will decay. So you must realize when you should now take off on a new cycle, take it up. Another, take it up. So this is the whole idea about personal development as well. So I think perfect timing, no? 9 o'clock, yeah. So sorry? You said something? Okay. So we have 9 sessions like this. 10th session is just only a paper. We will go through all this. This subject is an interesting subject because it opens up a lot of areas where you can do research and things like that. And also, more than anything else, case studies, if you are thinking.